hush comes over the crowd. Mm. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to the Weathersfield Planning and Zoning Commission, March 3rd, 2020. Would the clerk help me with the roll call, please?
Sir, Chairman Harley.
I am here.
Vice Chair Roberts.
Here.
I'm here. Mr. Hughes.
Yes.
Mr. Oikel.
Here.
Mr. Hammer. Mr. Homicki.
Here.
Mr. Dean.
Here.
Mr. Silver. Mr. Edwards. Ms. Antoniak.
Here.
Ms. Murphy.
Here.
All right, so we have nine members here, and everybody's participating. Would you like to move on?
Yes. New business item 3.1, the review of the 5-year capital improvement program.
Hello, stranger.
Hello. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the commission. My name is Derek Greger. I'm the town engineer. I'm here tonight with Robert Turgeon, who is the vice chairman of the Capital Improvement Advisory Committee. As you may remember, that committee is comprised of 5 residents that annually look at the town's project needs and make recommendations to the commission and to the council as to where capital funds should be spent. So for tonight, I just wanted to go through what our recommendations are for this year. Typically, we have 8 categories that they are broken out into. It's economic development, drainage, pavement maintenance, fire safety, sidewalks, town buildings, school buildings, and parks and rec. So I believe in your packets you all got a letter from the town manager that outlined the projects and the recommendations. Attachment A has a table with it that I was going to go through each one of these in this order and just kind of give you a brief summary of what the project is. Please feel free to stop me at any time if you have questions. Please know that everything that's on this particular spreadsheet on this list is not all the projects that were requested. It is only those that we were that the committee felt was warranted some funding, either full or partial funding, this year. So I'm going to start at the top of that list in the drainage category, Knott Street and Heather Drive drainage improvements. That project you had heard about last year. We have an icing situation at the intersection of Heather Drive and Knott Street. It's become a hazard. We've had issues with the road breaking up. It's hazardous condition, so we're looking and we need to put in some drainage in the area. So the project cost is estimated $130,000. Last year, $25,000 was allocated. The total cost, I'm sorry, is $155,000. So we got $25,000 last year, so now we're looking for $130,000 to finish out the project. So if we were allocated those funds, which is recommended right now, we'd be able to go to construction and address the issue. Those roads are going to be coming up. Heather Drive and Robbins Drive will be coming up on a paving program in the future, and we need to address this drainage problem before we get to that point. So that is the recommendation for that particular project. Number 2 is town dam repairs. In 2016, we had a consultant inspect 8 of the 9 town dams, and they determined 4 required minor repairs. That included the 1860 Reservoir, Griswold Pond, Millwoods Park Pond, and Millwoods Swimming Pond Dam, all located along Gulf Brook. The recommended amount, $50,000 this year, is a partial funding. That will allow us to get a consultant on board. They will start preparing dam safety permits for review by DEEP and start preparing construction documents. The worst one of the group is Millwood Swimming Pond Dam that needs the most attention, so we probably focus on that one first, get as much of that done as we can with this funding, and then plan to come back in a future year for the remaining funds. Moving on to the next category, pavement maintenance. Traffic sign inventory. In 2014, the Federal Highway Administration mandated that all municipalities implement and use an asset management system for all their signs. That is to make sure that signs have adequate retroreflectivity, which is at night. You get the light bouncing back off the sign. You see some signs are very bright, some are very faded. So the town is required to have a management system in place so we can keep track of which signs need replacement and try and make replacements every year
Derek,
to keep current.
Are you going to get rid of signs that aren't traffic signs? I mean, how about dedication signs on roadways that I wonder about? You know, they only add to the confusion of the motorists.
We will look at those on an individual basis, but for this particular project and this mandate, it's specific to traffic signs.
Just traffic.
Yes.
Itself,
so. Yes. So with that, these funds would allow us to retain a consultant. We estimate we have about 3,500 signs in town. They would go out, they would geolocate every sign, collect information about it, put it into a database that would then go into our GIS system, and we'd use that to manage the inventory going forward. So right now, we don't have a database really for our sign system, so that would allow us to have that. We'd have the retro reflectivity reading so we can keep track of where they are and then make improvements as we need to going forward and plan
Derek,
for capital
but you don't
jobs.
Take out the signs and just, they have a system from what I read in here that they can evaluate them, and they do go out physically and look at them though, I guess one at a time, right?
Yeah, they take measurements, they take photos, they measure the retro reflectivity.
That's the basis upon which the judgment is made by them and
Yeah, we've developed a database fields that we want populated. Okay. That's going to help us manage it going forward.
And if you see any bad ones, or they do see bad ones, they can call your attention to it. Because you probably don't have staff really adequate to handle signage right now.
We do have someone in physical services that handles sign replacements. As far as this project, we've tried to do it with staff over the last few years, and it's just we don't have time. And it's a moving target because signs are constantly being put up, maybe taken away. So we need to really grab all this data in one snapshot and have it and then be able to manage it going forward for us. If it takes us a number of years to do it, it's very complicated and hard to keep track of everything.
Excellent.
So that's what that recommendation was for. The second item is Straddle Hill Area Road Settlement. This was brought to my attention recently. We have a situation in this particular neighborhood, which is Straddle Hill, Silo Drive, Willow Street, and the surrounding roads. They were installed in the 1980s, and we're finding we're having settlement over the drainage and sanitary sewer trenches in a lot of areas throughout the neighborhood. We've been talking with MDC because it's affecting our storm drainage, and also it's over their sanitary sewers. We've done TV inspections of the pipes. The pipes look fine. So we have something else going on. The thought at this point is it might be related to construction material that was put in back in the 80s when they were built. Recent years we've had a lot of rainfall and high groundwater, and then we're thinking some of that groundwater could be transporting material causing problems in the trenches. They don't have fabric envelopes like they do today, so things were done a little bit differently back then. So this request really is to get a consultant on board to do some investigations out there. They're going to take some soil samples, do some test pits, do some testing of the material, and come up with some recommendations for us on how to address it.
Is the MDC cooperating with you on this?
Yeah, they've been helpful. We've been out there with them. Like I said, we've both done TV inspections. The town and them have been out there doing some temporary repairs because some of the settlement is potholes that are getting very dangerous. So some of that work's been done, but that was only a temporary measure because we know they're going to continue to settle. And once again, these roads will be coming up for paving in a future year, and this is one of those situations we have to get this figured out and addressed before we spend all the money on paving.
It is bad out there. My next-door neighbor asked me to go out and see his sisters where his sister was complaining about it to him. So I went out and looked at it a couple of years ago, and it was bad, so I understand what you're talking about.
Yeah, it's gotten particularly worse in the last couple of years, but my understanding, this has been going on for a while. This $50,000 recommendation would allow us to get the consultant on board. They'll evaluate the entire neighborhood. We also anticipate these funds will allow us to do the lower area of Straddle Hill for construction, which is the worst area, and let us at least get that portion of the road down there paved sooner than the rest of the neighborhood because it's in much worse shape. Next category is sidewalks. Our annual request for ADA detectable warning panels for sidewalk ramps. That is required by the U.S. Department of Justice that we meet ADA standards, particularly when we're making roadway improvements. So that this request includes being able to do ramps along our paving program roads so we can upgrade them, install detectable warning tires where they need it, full replacement, just to make sure they're in compliance before we pave. So that's a $25,000 request.
Mr. Chairman, another question on this one. Before my wife died, she was in a wheelchair for several years. And this is, I know, for the blind, those tiles. What would happen, I think I know what your answer is going to be, if we refuse to do those? Because I'd rather see, being on the chairing the sidewalk committee, sidewalk and biking committee, here in town right now, I'm concerned that the regular sidewalks get consideration. Instead, we have money in here with these tiles and I know what the requirements of the feds say to do, when you do your roads, you fix these, or whatever, or that's the decision that's been made. And what would happen if you refused to do them?
DOJ.
Take money away from us of some sort?
They could come in and cite us, and put us under an order to do all of our ramps or some portion of our ramps in a short time period. We are in recent years making an effort to meet their requirements, so at least we can say we are putting money to this and we are doing it every year. The sidewalk ramp replacements as well, I'm involved in that committee, as well as, you know, tied to sidewalk improvements as well. So the thought is, because we're doing the road paving, this would be the time to do the ramps that join them, and that is also what DOJ requires us to do. So it's a mandate, not so much a nice thing to have.
I'm just disappointed we're not got some money in for sidewalks.
Well, that's a discussion we can have going forward. Historically, the town has not invested in new sidewalks in areas, although, you know, that's certainly a discussion we can have. And I think part of that plan that...
Staff to get them repaired, yeah.
Right. So that might come out of the bike ped plan you were referring to as far as a recommendation that we might be able to utilize going forward. So the next category is town buildings. Miscellaneous roof repair consultant, $68,000. Tremco is the contractor that completes roof maintenance for our physical services department. This allocation would fund the final year of their five-year contract they've been working under. So physical services asked to have that funded so they can just finish out their contract, and then they'll be issuing a new contract following that. Item two is library RFID upgrade and return system. That's $8,000. This is the first phase of a project. The funds will be used. This is the radio frequency identification system. It needs to be upgraded to Windows 10 operating system. It's running on an old system. This is first phase. The idea is to get this up and running on the correct software. The librarian does intend to coming back in future years for requests to upgrade the equipment itself and to expand the equipment. Right now, it's a small request, but that at least gets the project started.
You said to Windows 10? So that's already a very outdated operating system. So I know this is a small amount. Is that just like the most current RFID system?
I'm not familiar with it. I can only go by what she had told me, but that's at least what they were planning on. If there's a, you know, if they're looking to go to a different system, I don't know. It might have limitations because it's an existing system that they're working off of. Maybe that's as far as they can go. Could be the case.
Phenomenal price, though, to replace all of that,
right? Well, this is just upgrading the operating system. There will be additional requests for upgrading the system.
Several million or something?
Well, that's another project where you're referring to. That's outside of actually the scope for this project. Item three, replace the roof on Firehouse 1, $118,000. Fire Station 1 down on Main Street had cedar roofs installed back in the 1970s. They've been leaking for a number of years. It's been an ongoing maintenance issue. It's been causing issues with mold within the structure. So staff has been working with the Historic District Commission on what will be required for shingles. They are working out different options. So right now this is a partial funding. Depending on what transpires with the Historic District Commission, the committee thought these funds may be adequate to actually do the project. If more expensive shingles are going to be required, then they may need additional funds in the future year. But right now it was partially funded to get the project started. Next item is roof routine maintenance, $25,000. Physical services just asked to have funds available for Tremco to provide routine roof maintenance in various areas when they need it. So this is to fund that work as needed going forward. Next item is replace town hall chiller and support systems for $50,000. This system was installed back in 1958. It was not replaced when we renovated the building back in 2006. This system provides cooling for a town hall and most of the library. Right now, it's just a $50,000 allocation as a partial funding towards the replacement of the entire system. My understanding, it's in very poor condition and at risk of failure at any time, so it's something that we wanted to get done sooner than later. Next category, school buildings. First item is replacement of Highcrest portable units. It's a $50,000 allocation. You may remember this from last year. The school's at 105% capacity. We have two existing portable units off the north side of the school that are no longer being used because they were deemed to be unsafe. Last year, council allocated $225,000 to the project. They went out to bid. They went out a little late in the season to have it done during summer construction. They had one bidder. It was a very high price, too high to move forward. So they've come back this year. It is currently out to bid. Again, bids will open this Friday. The request here to put some additional funds into it. They think the initial request should be sufficient, but because of the fact we did get a high bid last time, they'd just like to add a little bit more contingency to the project. So that's what this request is for. The next item is replacing the roofs at High Crest School. Tremco has provided the town with a cost estimate of $550,000 to do all three roofing systems. Right now, the request is for $100,000, which is a partial funding. That money would at least allow the town to get started for replacing the roof and gutters over the auditorium and the hallway, which are the worst areas at the school right now. So it's at least to get some of that project done.
Wait, will the state be reimbursing part of them, you think, you hope?
I don't know what the discussions have been. I don't know about roofs. I know there's been some discussions with the state regarding the portable units and such, but I don't know if the roofs are actually part of that or not.
Okay, well, I'm at the, isn't it the buildings? No? Portable units? No, or are you talking about the High Crest School roof? I meant the portable units, I'm sorry.
Oh, yeah, there's been some discussion with the state. I can't say I know the details on how that works. Yeah.
I hope so.
Okay, next item is replacing the flooring at Hanmer and Charles Wright Schools. This project was funded previously. What happened last year or the year before, we had an issue with Silas D. Mills School. We had an emergency situation with the roofs. So the money that was put into this project was diverted to Silas D. Mills School to have that addressed quickly. So now Physical Services has come back for additional request to do this work. The existing tiles have asbestos in the mastic. So town's looking at replacing those with different flooring options. This is just partial funding of $25,000 at this time to get the project started. Next item is replace stairs at Webb School. The main entrance to Webb School along Willow Street has a lot of safety issues with the stairs. This has been going on for a while. There was a pine tree that used to be there that contributed a lot to some of the deterioration of the concrete that has since been removed. Physical Services field staff can't continue to patch it. It's just gotten to be too bad at this point. So this $55,000 allocation is funding for a complete replacement of the stairway in the front of the building. So category Parks and Rec, Nature Center, concrete sidewalk and ADA ramp, $16,000. We have some safety issues at the main entrance to the Nature Center from the parking lot. There's issues with the ADA ramp along as well as the sidewalk, so these funds would be used to complete repairs at that location.
Has that contract been selected yet by the council?
Are we talking about the sidewalk program for the next? That just opened on Friday, so we were evaluating the bids.
I went over there and looked at it today. I'm not an expert sidewalk contractor or an expert at it, but it seemed high to me, the cost of it.
But. Well, there's some contingency built into this, yes. So. Next item, community center, renovate interior, $30,000 request. The carpet in the lobby in the main hallway was installed back in 1996. Carpet is starting to buckle, seams are coming apart. It's becoming more and more difficult to keep clean. So our director of Parks and Recreation has asked for these funds to be used to replace the carpet. They're looking at some different flooring options, tile, some kind of concrete flooring at this location at the entrance. Next project is the Millwoods Little League Field, which is also known as Classic Field, over at the park. There's a lot of issues with drainage out there at the field. We have a lot of clay. We've dug test pits. We have clay out there. When it rains, it's very flat. Water sits there. It becomes an issue for use of the field, and it is something that is a problem, from what I understand, almost year-round. So even when it's warming in the summer, they have soggy conditions out there. So this project would allow for regrading the field, installing a new drainage system that would extend from the northwest our northeast corner of the field from the parking lot. We have to run some drainage up around to the west side of the field to pick up drainage that's coming off the hill down from Griswold Road. That system has been designed so it can be extended to the south. There's also an issue with the softball field similarly to the south of Classic Field where they play soccer and softball has the same situation. So this phase one of the project was designed so we can come back at a later date and extend it. The $25,000 recommended allocation is in addition to the $25,000 that was added last year, so it's another partial funding, but it does get us a little closer to being able to get the project done. Solomon Wells House repairs, $25,000. The roofs were replaced last year on the building. Our consultant has recommended that we need exterior repairs to the shingles, porch, windows, railings, and painting. So this is $25,000 just to partially start funding that work. That summed up to the $900,000 that the committee was initially tasked with coming up with projects for. In the event there's some additional funding through town council, they identified a couple of other projects that they would recommend for funding. The first one is the Keesha Farm Master Plan Study, $75,000. That is to retain a consultant to come in and have a process to evaluate options for the newly purchased Keesha Farm parcel. Right now, RFPs were obtained a couple weeks ago. They're being evaluated. There's a committee in place that's going to help navigate that process. There will be opportunity for public involvement and comment as we go through. So right now, that would be our economic development category for that project. And then the additional $25,000 to make it an even million would be put towards the replacement of Highcrest portable units if there was a need. As I stated earlier, there's a partial funding that's being added to the funds that are already there. If there's a need for more, they would recommend putting the balance into that. So we have to answer any questions.
Good. Rich?
So just so I understand on the Highcrest portables, we have 250 sitting out there that's already been allocated to that in the prior year. When the bids came in last year, they were in the, you know, the 400 plus range. So that's where this 212 came from. But your expectation is that you won't need 212?
This was discussed at length with the committee. The committee's feeling was that based on the consultant's estimate, which is still what it was previously, they had 225 allocated last year. The thought is because they put out the bid much earlier, just because of the timing last year, we were just getting the funds awarded. Now we have the funds, so it's already out to bid. So the thought is because it's done earlier, we'll have more competition and better results. We can't say for sure at this point. I mean, we'll know Friday, so it won't be too long. We'll actually know where we are, and there's time to make adjustments if need be. But at the time we were discussing it, the committee felt that they didn't feel like they needed to put so much money into that one project. They wanted to leave some available for other projects, so that's why they partially funded it.
Yeah, I guess my thought on that is that, you know, as you said, the school's at 105% capacity. They're teaching classes in the gymnasium. They're doing music in the hallways. You know, I consider getting those portables installed and back online to be a higher priority than probably 16 of the 18 things on this list. So, you know, when I first saw it, I was thinking, like, what are we doing? Like, setting aside 50 a year toward the 400, but, you know, I think it's important to get a project finished, and that's obviously one that's probably 10 years overdue. The other question I had is that on a number of these, you referred to, you know, where, you know, just pick a number, you know, the town hall chiller is 200 and you put 50 in there. Is that to seed money to pay for the 200, or is that to do 50 worth of work? And, you know, I think there are probably half a dozen in here that are kind of in the category where you said something like, you know, to get the project started or to get this going. And I just wanted to be clear whether you were actually going to be doing something with the money to remediate these problems, or whether it's just setting it into an account to be dealt with once you reach the appropriate quantity of money.
Okay. Just with respect to the Highcrest portables, I know that's a high priority project for the town, so I suspect, you know, once we get to next week and we know where the bids are, I suspect the town's going to want to fund that, and if that requires us to shift some of these around, that may happen. Hopefully that won't be necessary, but we'll know better. With respect to your other question regarding funding, some of these projects are the funding that's partial will go towards hiring a consultant or getting some of the design permitting done. Other particular categories, it's really just to put, we know we need 200,000, so they're putting a certain amount in now. They know they're going to have to come back and refund it, which through this process over the years has been typical. A lot of times they'll do partial funding for put it in the kitty so it's there, and then, you know, we have such little amount of money to work with. I know in the past the committee has tried to finish projects, so where they've done this in the past, they'll come in and say, all right, let's just finish out, like the first one, not in Heather Drive as an example. They just say, all right, let's just get this done. So sometimes they'll put a little bit in and then try and get to a point where they say, all right, now we can just finish it off. So try not to make it such a big hit at one time on one project when we have so many needs.
Yeah, I mean, I understand that, and I do agree that this is not enough money to do what needs to be done, and we're probably getting further behind this year. But I guess, you know, my thinking is just pick something like the, you know, the firehouse roof. You know, if it were to require the entire amount of money, I would rather spend the entire amount of money in one year just to stop the mold and the leaking and so forth, rather than hoping next year there isn't some more dire need for $118,000 because, you know, Straddle Hill washed down all the way to Willow Street or something like that. So, you know, just getting things done.
Do you want to speak to that?
Yeah. Hi, my name is Bob Turgeon. I've been on the committee for 13 years now. And this year we were given $3 million in requests and $900,000 to work with, speaking to the cooling unit project. $50,000 with talking to fiscal services was enough to get them to get an engineer online to start to work out all their permits and everything they need to do to get the project started. The rest of the project can't be done until that is completed, and it's gonna take them almost the entire year to get to that point. So to fund the entire project didn't make sense. The salt shed took us
20 years,
5 years, once we finally started funding it, but it became a real priority. The committee works very hard to try and complete projects, but we also try and work to give them the money they need to get them started, and then give them the rest of the money they need to finish them when they actually need the money, rather than funding the entire project and having it sit in account for 2 years. Excuse me. Same thing with the portable units of the schools. We asked a lot of questions about the portable units, including buying used ones, because we've been told that there's a plan to go through the entire school system, figure out which schools are going to be redone. There's talk about adding on to Highcrest, spending $500,000 on portables if you're going to redo the school in 4 years. Sounds like a lot of money. We asked about portables. We were also told the units clear everything. Health department, building department, they all said the ones that are there are fine, but the teachers don't want to use them. I understand that. They're 20 years old. They had mold in the walls. It's been cleaned out. So the committee's doing its best, and the partial projects, a lot of them, is the money they need to get started, but they don't need the full amount of the project until they're ready to actually move forward with construction and stuff. We work very hard to try and finish projects, but the amount of money that we're given to work with, I mean, if we had a full, everybody's, we'd love to. The Little League field's important, but it's going to be a couple of years before it actually gets done because there's just not enough money for everything. And things like the school and the roofs on Highcrest, we base our decisions based on the information we're given. Highcrest, roofs have been leaking. They've been patching them. They can keep doing it maybe another year or two. Ideally, you'd like to get it done. The $100,000 we want to put towards it, we'll get one of the three roofs on top done. And then next year, hopefully, we can come up with the rest of the money to do those, and some of the other departments won't be asking for things. Fire department, they're looking for a roof on the firehouse. It's the only thing they asked for this year. Police department didn't ask for anything this year. When I first started on this committee, the way the committee tried to do it was they tried to give a little something to everybody and just try and keep everybody happy, and nothing got completed. So I understand your questions, but the $50,000, it's not going to be just sitting in an account. It's going to be used to get the project to a point where they're ready for the rest of the funding, and we can go ahead and fund the rest of the project.
Yeah, I mean, that was the point of my question.
Yeah.
Is, you know,
yep,
if it's a partial
that's
funding,
exactly what it is. It's not just sitting there in limbo until
okay.
They get enough to even start. It's enough to get them to get the engineer on board to figure out all the blueprints and everything else for how the cooling tower is going to be placed and everything.
Right. I just wanted to be clear that that was what.
Yep, that's what it is, and that's what most of these partial things are.
Okay.
Either that or the numbers are just so big that we just can't do more than that, so we have to try and it's based on how long they think they have until the project's going to be a complete necessity as to how we try and fund them.
So that last statement kind of contradicts what you just said, because that's what I was thinking as I was reading this. If there's an engineer to be hired because there's a project coming up, I think I would fully support that, right? Keep the project moving. But if you're just putting $50,000 toward $250,000 project aside this year and expecting it to be funded 5 years from now, that goes back to the way you indicated 13 years ago was happening. You were trying to appease everybody, and 30 different projects got a nickel, and you didn't get any of them done, right?
No, it would be the salt shed project. It took us 5 years to completely fund that project.
So I'm just going to present my preference when I see these lists. If something can get started, that's fine. But if we're just putting money to the side for, you know, that fully funded project 5 years from now, 6 years from now, 10 years from now, I don't think that's the right way to do it personally. I'd rather make the hard choice and decide this year what's our priority and fund it. But there are absolutely needs to keep projects moving forward. And so if you're going to take 20, 30, 50 grand to hire someone to get the job started, that's a different thing entirely. I did hear a few of them here that sounded like you were just putting it to the side this year, and that doesn't make sense to me. I'd rather you fully fund one of the two or three projects that were going on. That's all.
I understand what you're saying, but like I said, the salt shed money was put in to get it started. The site survey was done. But then they actually build the entire salt shed. It was 3 more years to come up with the full amount of money, just because the amount of money we have to work with and the number of projects, and there are a lot of them that need to be done right away.
Yep. I mean, if we'd given you more money, could you have gotten a color other than orange for it?
That one I couldn't answer.
Okay.
Don't take our comments as a criticism either. I know you're volunteering, right? It's a hard job.
I appreciate what you're saying. I feel the same way. I mean, when I started on a committee, like I said, it was a lot different than it is now. We try and focus on getting things done and getting them done as quickly as possible. And I think we've done a pretty good job with it. Unfortunately, there's only so much money to go around.
Yeah, I mean, and the 900 is probably the same number we've been using for 20
exactly,
years.
Exactly.
It was a little more than that going back 10 years ago. But going back 10 years ago, the roads were also included in this same plan, and it was a much bigger budget, but 90%
yeah, it was like $2 million altogether,
yeah,
and
yeah.
2.5 when you had LOSIP and town aid and all the road money.
Mr. Hughes?
Thank you very much for your volunteering. This is not an easy deal to do that. There's just not enough pie to go around, but thank you for your time.
You're welcome. No,
just one quick question. So what happens when the bids come in even higher than the one bid we got last year for the 105% Highcrest School and the portable classrooms? Where are we getting the money? Now do we want to look at this again and peel some of this off? Should we make a cut now so they make sure they have enough money in it?
Well, I'm not sure exactly how that'll work. I mean, there are options. We have some capital reserve. We have the option town council can always make changes. These are recommendations coming from the committee, recommendations from the commission to town council. So if there's a known need at that time, then they may opt to move money from some of these projects to others. That is certainly a possibility.
But at 105% capacity, I mean, it's not, with all due respect, it's not a salt shed. It's kids. And if they didn't think it was that important last year, even if they were paying a premium at the end of the year, I mean, what makes us think they're going to rob Peter to pay Paul right now when the bids don't come in where they're, you know.
Yeah, that'd be cool.
We're hoping they come in. They may come in lower, but, you know, we don't know.
It's hard for me to say because it's not my project. The director of physical services, town manager, would have to speak to that as to how they would handle that situation.
Because the richest point, I would rather make some adjustments on this sheet right now, with all due respect to the committee who put it together. I'd rather have too much money in the portable classroom budget and be able to reallocate it down this list with whatever's left over than doing it reverse, not having enough, and trying to look around and see where they can scrape, scrounge, and cut on a panic situation. But I don't think they can put it off another year, I wouldn't think, but I'm not making that decision.
Yeah, I suspect you can make whatever recommendations you would like going forward from what you're seeing today. Like I said, we'll have that particular project. We'll know more at the end of this week. Just unfortunately, we don't know tonight. So, you know, that's certainly within your purview.
Thanks, I appreciate that.
You have a priority column list here. Does that get reviewed every year and revisited last year versus next year? Does the committee look at the priorities? And
the priority list for on this particular table is just for these projects, so they ranked these as the highest priority. So to the point where if additional funds were needed, ideally, you would think that the lowest priority projects may be the ones that lose out, because that's one of the reasons they rank them. If there's a need to transfer funds or there's not as many funds as we thought, at least the committee has come up with their recommendation on what's the first to the last priority. So that's why they do that.
Make a motion that we give a positive report on the 824 review of the five-year capital improvement program with the one comment that fully funding the Highcrest portable replacements in the 2021 fiscal year should be a high priority.
I'll second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? All right, terrific. Thanks, Derek.
Thank you.
Good job. Thank you, gentlemen, for all the good work you put into it.
Moving on, item 3.2, public hearing, application 2035-20Z, Tomas Duda. Seeking a special permit in accordance with section 36C2, accessory building and structures of the Weathersfield zoning regulations to install a utility building slash shed larger than permitted, 20 by 30, which is 600 square feet, exceeding the maximum height also permitted, which is 19 3/4, in a residential zone at 373 Prospect Street.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Tomas Duda, and I live on 373 Prospect Street. I'm here to, in regards to an application, to request a variance to put up a 20 by 30 utility building at a max height about 20 feet. Today I have a 540 square foot garage, two-car garage, which is not sufficient space. And I feel that this utility building would help me with the extra room and space. Today I have a temporary tent in my backyard, which is not very appealing. I would like to remove that and make that yard look a little bit more better and organized. This structure, this building would be for strictly personal use and just for my personal use only. And just to keep myself more organized. In regards to my neighbors, my neighbor in the back, in the rear, Tom, had some concerns about the size of the building and some abrevieties trees that are growing across the rear lane. I'll make sure I have the building at least 10 feet away from that property line to make sure the trees are not in any way of an impact. On the right side, I have a neighbor that we have a ton of trees between the two properties. I spoke to her. Well, I'll go and clean up all those trees just to remove that safety hazard. They're just old and fallen over, so I think that'd be a good thing to go clean it up and make that side of the yard look very, very presentable. And she's okay with it.
What do you mean by clean it up? With those, take those trees out?
Yes.
The big ones?
Yes.
And plant what there?
Abrevieties and possibly put a fence in between the 2 yards.
Like your neighbor behind you?
Yes.
Thank you.
And I feel like this structure will make my property more presentable. The property value will go up, my property value, and the surrounding neighbors as well. Any questions?
How far back from the property line are you going to put it? On the right side, primarily, even the back side.
On the right side would be between 10 and 15 feet. 10 and 15 feet. On the right side. I have plenty of room.
And the zone is 5 feet?
Yes. And same thing on the back.
So there is a, I assume it's the neighbor to whom you're referring to. I think you said Tom, right?
Yes, he's
here. There's a letter in the file. I'll just read it because it is a public hearing. His name is Tom Anderson. Did he actually say, he's just got concerns. I don't think he's saying fully opposed. But anyways, it's rather large. It's 600 square feet versus the 200. He questions the setbacks that will be used, so thank you for bringing that up. And will the building be used for personal or commercial use? And I heard personal.
That's correct.
I'm guessing it will be housed to use vehicles and equipment, though?
Yeah, I have two classic cars.
Gotcha. All right.
You're a car buff.
Yes, I love the cars.
You work on them.
There's another piece of correspondence in the file from Carol Zeminski in support of the shed. I'll leave it at that. All right. Any other questions for the applicant? I guess I'm wondering just, you know, why do we need something quite so big? Why can't it be under 18 feet?
So the height, it's a kit. So the kit is at 19 3/4. So I was just going to buy a kit and put it out there. That's why the height. The size, I have two classic cars, a motorcycle, two snowblowers, and the garage space, two-car garage space is just not sufficient. And I have a Kubota tractor as well that I like to go putz around and work on a yard with. And that's why I have that temporary building, and it just doesn't look nice. I put it up last year, I think, and I just want to get rid of it and make that area more presentable.
You'll have electricity out there?
I haven't thought about that yet. I think to run electricity, I'd have to go under my driveway, so probably in a year or so when I replace the driveway.
So you won't have a lot of lighting that'll distract from the neighborhood or anything like that? Spotlights or anything that the neighbors should be aware of?
So if you look at my yard sits very back. On the right side, I actually have two neighbors.
Your site plan shows it quite a bit farther back.
Yes,
to the rear. Yeah.
How
about plumbing? You won't have any plumbing out
no
there?
No plumbing. Definitely no plumbing.
How big is your lot?
I think about 3/4 acre.
Is it one of the bigger ones in 1/4 mile of your house?
I would say probably the biggest one, I think, in the area.
Well, there is one above you that's large, but the house is big.
Okay. But it's a good size lot.
You do have a two-car garage, or
yes.
A regular one,
yes.
Under the house.
Yes.
So still, the chairman is correct. Why this large design, and it is 3 times larger, so that concerns me a little bit too.
Okay, so power and no power, but no plumbing.
Right? Definitely no plumbing. Power in the future.
Wait. Okay.
Is the power for you to be able to work in the shed?
Just for lights.
This is a public hearing. Is there anybody in the public who wishes to speak? Oh, excellent. This lady had her hand up first, if you'd join us. And if you would see the mic, yes.
I don't think we personally met. I'm actually across the street from you.
Oh, how are you?
I'm Yetzi.
I'm Tomas.
I'm actually Nancy Downey at 360 Prospect Street, diagonally and right across the street. And I guess I'm not so much concerned about the building, even though the size of it is about half the size of my house, but I'm concerned about the lighting. And as an example, you have a big truck with big floodlights on the top.
Yes.
When that points a certain direction across the street at my house, early in the morning or late at night, it lights up my whole house. So I'm concerned about the lighting that's going to be up on this. He is on a hill. We're down the bottom. It's Prospect Street as it goes up from Olney to, I forget the next street. So a truck, a building up high with lights, bright floodlights shining across the street is very concerning and distracting, and that would be my concern.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Richard Williams, 378 Prospect Street. I'm a little confused because my lot, if you get out a plan, is completely across the street from this house. I have no problem at all with it. Ever since he's bought it, I've lived there 20 years. I think he's been there
five
years, and everything he's done with the property is excellent. When I sit in my front room, I look right out, and I have no problem. I'm in support of the applicant.
Question. He keeps the front of the yard in his yard generally good.
Excellent.
The front of it. It's in good shape.
He says that he's going to clean it up. I'm saying I don't even see the need for it. But, you know, he's that type of person that it's top shelf. So
yeah,
I got no problem at all.
And it's a big lot.
So. It's a good size lot.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Tom Anderson. I had written the letter. I didn't expect to be here this evening. My big concern is the size of the unit. It will clean up the backyard. There's a lot of construction material. What is it, a trailer?
I have a trailer and there's wood for splitting.
And the vehicles, if they're going to be stored in there, does that make it a garage? I don't know. If it does, then there may be, in addition to the 600 square feet for a utility building exceeding the 200, there may be an issue about being an additional garage. That's my big concern.
Thank you. All righty. So, is there somebody else?
Tom.
Too late.
Too late.
He sat down.
I'm going to give him some exercise.
I need it. Yeah.
Are you happy? Not happy. Bad term. You got any concern with the looking out at him, either from your house or any of what you think might be there?
Yeah, the size. It's going to be 20 feet tall.
Why is the size that important?
Well, we have arborvitaes in the backyard that are about 10 feet tall.
Yeah, right.
And this would,
nice setup,
and this would be another 10 feet above that.
Well, they'll grow big. Not right away.
Whether or not they'll get the full sunlight. I was concerned more, you know, if he was going to build it at 5 feet in back of our property line, those trees may die, you know.
Yeah.
And the plan did not specify what the back the setback would be.
So now he's making a decent setback, I think. He said, what'd you say, 15 feet?
10 minimum feet.
15 feet, both back of it and side.
I can do 15, yes.
So, does that help?
It helps, yeah. It helps, but there's still going to be a 600 square foot building that's 20 feet tall.
Now, you don't intend to put the shrubbery like he has near his fence or his shrubbery? You don't think there's a need because he has it on his side, right?
Yeah, I might put some nice little shrubs in front of it, but not as high. There's
yeah,
no
but
need
not,
for
not
higher.
Those.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions?
No, I'm on
okay.
That side. That's good. Thank you. I'm sorry. Didn't
okay.
mean to leave it hanging.
Is there anybody else in the public? All righty. Okay. Any other questions for the applicant? All right. So what we've heard, and I think you heard it from my own questions, is the is the lighting from it. So I think I'd be more comfortable if, you know, for the record, we were saying the lighting, first of all, has requirements on the outside of the structure, right? So I would hate the lighting that ends up on the outside of the structure someday to be contrary to town code. In the meantime, if you don't have it lit at all, that's wonderful. But we all know you're going to have power inside.
Yeah.
It needs to have power inside. Why would you have it without it? So I don't think we have any concerns about it. I don't have any concerns about that. The height is 19 feet. It's 1 foot over 18. I don't personally see that as a big issue. It is the size in my mind, but, you know, it's a big piece of property. Does anybody have any additional questions for the applicant, or I'll entertain a motion? Unless you want to ask him some questions specific to what's going in your mind.
That's what I want to do, yeah. So I had a question about the elevation of
yep.
the shed with respect to the rest of the property or that of your abutting neighbors. So when I was looking at Google Maps,
yep.
it looked like that area where you want to put the shed in is a little bit lower than the surrounding property, or is it the same elevation or higher? So in other words, would that shed be actually higher for your surrounding neighbors or lower based on on your property?
The ones you depends how you look at it.
Yeah.
So if you look at my house, it sits right on a hill on a Prospect Street.
Mm-hmm.
So if you look at the neighbor to my left side, it will be down in the bottom. If you look out to the neighbor to my right side, since they sit lower, it'll be a little bit higher. In the back, I think it'll be pretty leveled. And same thing in front.
Have you thought about making the size of the shed any smaller, or is that the, you know, is it the kind of thing if you make it smaller, you can't put in what you actually were planning on doing, or you gave yourself a little bit of a cushion?
So it's
pretty big.
It is pretty big. So if I thought about doing a garage, so I'm allowed to do another 300 square feet of garage to be within that 800. So if I do a 300 square foot garage and another 200 square foot shed, I'm on about 500 square feet. So I'm not really asking for much more, but I just want to kind of consolidate it so it looks a little bit better and nicer as one building versus two separate buildings. So that's kind of my thought behind it. Versus putting two structures up, just do one that looks neater and probably takes up less space as one versus two.
Like, is there a cupola in the plans?
A what?
A cupola.
A cupola.
One of the drawings shows either a chimney or a cupola.
No.
Okay. So, any questions for the applicant, or should we close the hearing?
Motion to close.
Is there
second?
All right. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? All right. Thank you. We're going to start talking about it now.
Thank you, sir.
Yes.
The thing that I look at this site, it's a big site, and it's not like a lot of them that we've encountered over the last 5 or 10 years, particularly where somebody comes in and wants to put an additional building in or something on, and they're on a very small lot, which is very much the case north of him, where I live, and that whole area from Prospect to Wells Road, east of the ridge, and a lot of the small lots. And his is quite different in that sense. And his back area and side is open right now, pretty much. His garage, two-car garage, is in under. You can't even see it from the street. I think it's not an unreasonable request that he's making, and he wants it because on this commission, before many of the commissioners sitting here are on it, we had a similar request over on Golf Road. Guy was into cars and not a mechanic, not a backyard mechanic servicing people. He has a very expensive historic car, and for example, in his garage right now, and showed it to me. And for example, he does that kind of, he has that kind of interest in work. So he's providing that for himself, and I think it's a positive effort on his part. It's just we have to put in some requirements and any approval for the shrubbery or trees along the side and that kind of thing. So that's what I would recommend in any motion.
Are you making a motion?
I'll make a motion and I'll look for anyone who wants to add to it. But I want a 15-foot setback around this building that he's putting in, and take down the existing trees on the right side and put up, what did he say he wanted?
Arborvitaes.
Okay. I don't know if that makes the type of, the arborvitae makes sense to the other commissioners. Maybe there could be another type shrub, but I think that's as good as any, and it grows eventually. Sometimes it's 10, 12 feet tall. I've encountered it in my own yard and my neighbor across the street. I look at it every day. So
maybe you just say arborvitae or other similar natural vegetative screening.
Evergreen screening, yeah. Right. Yeah, I don't want deciduous in there, no.
Okay, so what I heard was a motion to approve cleaning up trees on the right side, some arborvitae or evergreen screening material, 15-foot minimum side and rear lot offset. No plumbing is what I would suggest. Lights to meet the town code. We expect power in the building, but no plumbing. I already said no plumbing, right? And no cupola.
Second. Yeah, second with all of that.
All right. Any further discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? All right.
Congratulations. When are you going to build it? I walk that neighborhood.
It's going to be setting aside money over the next 7 years.
And I want to come by there and see if next year.
Get an engineer out there this year.
We ask contractors, you know, for that, but not homeowners. I've never asked a homeowner.
George, we're not done.
Exactly.
All right.
Next item.
Item 4.1, pre-application review, Heirloom Market and Comstock, at Comstock, seeking review of proposed expansion and renovation at 263 Main Street.
I'm going to recuse myself from this, but I'm going to stay here because these chairs are more comfortable.
Do you hear things differently up here?
Yeah, I hear things.
Actually.
And if they show plans, I get to see the front of them instead of the back of them.
This isn't a conflict of interest?
I'm not doing anything. It's a pre-application conflict.
Being able to see the plans.
And I'm not going to say anything.
Okay, so
hello,
you,
if you would.
Just a quick question. You have copies of the narrative. Do you have copies of the of this as well?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, all right, perfect. I'm Julia Kaloris. My husband, Spiro Kaloris. We own Heirloom Market. Okay. So, do you want me to start or do you want to start? Okay. So, this is just our pre-approval, obviously. We want to make sure that we're going about everything the right way. And so, here's our beginning stages. Existing right now is a cafe. We would like to expand the kitchen into the existing, like, you know, kitchen area, but put in a real kitchen. We're going to do a hood system, add some better equipment, and then also expanding the cafe area, so like the counter area, so there's better display. It's all interior, it's not really, there's no like exterior, we're not adding any buildings or anything like that. And then hopefully in the back barn, which is out past the greenhouse, to turn that into some real event space. Right now, or when we took over, it had been used as assembly, but we're not sure if it's actually zoned for that, so we're just figuring out some, I guess, logistics with that, yeah, to figure out what we need to do. But hopefully that can be an event space. Our idea is to have kind of a tap room, like, slash event space. So it can be used on a day-to-day basis, but could also be used for bridal showers, baby showers, birthday parties, small weddings. So that's it. It's really a three-stage process. And included in that is replacing doors on the back barns, some doors on the front building, a lot of fixing, doing some siding work, some roofing work, updating, making things better.
That's basically the gist of it. So in terms of exterior, things will be visible. We are currently talking with a couple contractors about the best possible locations for the hood. And depending on really what's the most financially feasible for us. We are looking to either go into this area here, you see here. It looks like it says kitchen and it says hotline in the back. The only other option that would be a bit of a caveat to that would be is if it makes more sense to have the hood be just on the other side of that wall with the back, where the current cafe is. That would all be determined on what would be the most convenient place for ductwork and the things that have to go along with that. But yeah, that's basically just it. I mean, obviously we'd be applying for a liquor permit, beer and wine, maybe possibly a whole full cafe liquor permit.
So if the work that you're proposing is within the shell of the existing structure, which I assume it is, right? The things that first come to my mind is the parking draw and then the alcohol. right, that liquor license and whether it would pass muster. So with those two items, did you add any comments or
thoughts? They had a workshop with some of the staff last week. I was not around, so I wasn't privy to maybe more of the details. Certainly, I heard parking came up, maybe you want to tackle these one at a time. So maybe you could speak a little bit to what your parking plan would be.
Sure. We've had communication with the church across the street, and well, you could speak to because you've actually had the...
Yeah, Todd Willard over at the church has agreed to let us use during event times, if you're looking straight out from Comstock Ferry across the street to the church, there's like a brick building and then a yellow building, and there's a smaller lot there. I tried to find out exactly how many spots he has there, but basically they said we could have access to that lot at any time. So if we are having a baby shower, bridal shower, small wedding, whatever, they can even put in their invitation ample parking across the street, just walk across the street. And like, it was perfect on Sunday. There was actually a after luncheon funeral with us. The funeral was right there at the church. It was super convenient. They just walked across the street, and they actually made mention of that, how nice it was that there was plenty of parking for that. So hopefully that will offset any concern with the parking. I think we have definitely enough for our day to day, and anything that this would add in addition to what we're doing now would be offset from our normal right now hours. So I don't think it would bring up too much of an issue, because like if the tap room and we were doing something on an after hours event, it might be like 5 to 6 to 9 or so at night, where right now we're closed at 5 anyway, so the parking lot's empty. Right. So hopefully it'll, you know, flow good.
And to be clear, like our vision for the back barn is for it to be an event space. And the reason what we're talking about is putting in that small bar, it essentially just be a row of taps. There's all this, everyone's coming and asking us over and over again every day, how come there's not a brewery in there? Well, we're not brewers, and we're not interested in opening a brewery. What we want to do is kind of have a tap room so that we can utilize a space and make some sales when there's not an event there, and have almost like beer hall hours that are similar to breweries. They close early, they're open probably 3 or 4 days a week, and usually closed by 8 o'clock or something like that. And because we want to be conscious of the neighbors and that are adjacent to the parking lot as well.
Yeah.
I see on the plan you have a new, is that an outside patio that you're proposing? Maybe you could speak to what you envision happening there. There are neighbors obviously there, and
sure.
We've had some issues with some other permits that I won't mention with outside activity, so maybe you could speak a little bit to that.
Sure. Right now, the back walkway that the current landlords put in, I don't think they kind of foresaw kind of the erosion that happens back there because of runoff from the building. So there's a portion of that needs to be rebuilt anyway. So what we were discussing was continuing this walkway that currently ends. You look out the back door here, it pretty ends here and then comes right down here and connects to the two handicap spots. So what we considered is that we would want some kind of walkway from this door to here naturally. And so basically putting in pavers to go all the way over and just coming out slightly. We don't have exact dimensions to that, but this is again pretty preliminary. But we were just considering if there was 2 or 3 picnic tables back there.
It wouldn't go to the greenhouse door there and call it?
It would go around
along the side door there over.
Correct, yeah. So it would go along the side of the greenhouse that you see from the parking lot. All this
right, and then in there, so, yeah, okay.
Right, because it's just kind of like loose timbers and stuff like that.
I highly recommend it.
Yeah.
And you're here to get advice from us today.
Yeah, absolutely. So
I have a couple of other suggestions. Yeah. Go ahead, that's a principle.
Yeah, so we would go and just connect that. If we were connecting that and putting all that work in there, then perhaps we could have that as a senior as well.
Because in the old days, they used to go through the greenhouse all the time, and that didn't make sense to me back then. And
yep.
Certainly can't do it now because you're not using it. And you don't plan to use it.
Yeah, the greenhouse has
right now.
Many different levels of flooring.
We might use it eventually. This is like definitely phase one. We want to update as much as we can and make usable space there. And the greenhouse is a beautiful space. I mean, nobody has anything like that, especially with
That's true.
Somewhere we could sit and have lunch in February and be 70 degrees. Well, we can, I guess we get that anyway.
You don't have to go to Elizabeth Park.
Right, yeah, so maybe phase two or three, but right now, we wouldn't do much in there.
Other than we'd be doing the repairs that need to be done, that we have money allocated to. You know, there's part of the siding that's falling off around the perimeter of the greenhouse that need to be repaired. The motors need to be fixed so that they open and close. The fans need to be working. And also that back wall.
Right. And our renovations would be addressed at all that's deteriorating right now.
Peter, would you explain to me, for their benefit, too, I got a discussion here, the parking issue. They meet the parking requirements of the existing operations now. It's this back area here that requires more spaces? I don't understand.
Basically, yeah. So there isn't, but
we allow every merchant down there to use the street parking, right?
So they would present their plan in more detail to you with a parking calculation attached to see what the difference is between what they have and what they don't have. And obviously they're planning on supplementing that with use of the church's parking. So you would have to analyze that at the time. Obviously, your regulations.
You're doing a parking study of Old Weathersfield anyway.
Yeah, I mean, there is, you know, using the church's parking lot, if that could be factored into the overall parking situation in Old Weathersfield. I mean, that's the single largest parking lot in Old Weathersfield. So, it only gets used at limited certain times. So if it can be factored into the overall plan, makes sense for everybody.
And they have provided us with some correspondence saying that it was okay to use their lot as well.
So we would need to, as part of your application, just that would be part of all of that, right?
Sure.
Yep.
And I think Peter mentioned the history of outdoor entertainment space and the issues that have come up over the years. So I'm not suggesting you shouldn't have it. I'm just suggesting it's got to be thoughtful.
Yeah. So. Our original thoughts are to just kind of start off with that we wouldn't have outdoor amplified. If we were going to have anything outside, it would be acoustic. Obviously, if we were doing a wedding or something inside, there would probably be amplified music inside. But we, like, our plan, our business plan is not to be an open to last call any type of place ever. So I think we would have a cap on that. And to help with our neighbors and stuff too, maybe it would be a 10 p.m. On a night that we might have an actual wedding.
Right,
but
absolutely.
I mean, so far up until now, it's mostly luncheons that we're doing. So, you know, we hope to expand, but I don't know, you know, we're not looking to get into that late night outdoor thing.
That's a business that we like to consider ourselves retired from.
We already did that.
So for many, many years. So that's part of the reason why we opened up Heirloom Market, to be quite honest, is that, you know, we had opportunities to go into the restaurant business and open up cocktail bars and things like that. But when this actually started to become a reality for us, it was something we were very conscious of, just as far as a quality of life issue, selfishly for ourselves and for our family. You know, we don't want to be open to last call, so that's not something that's going to be in our plan. So again, like, you know, if you notice kind of the trend with Connecticut breweries, a lot of them are busiest in the afternoon. And, you know, and there it's a Thursday through Sunday situation. So we imagine that back barn, you know, not being any kind of like, it's like just imagine a traditional beer hall on the days that it's not an event. You know, people filling up growlers so they can take home with them. You know, we'd be featuring, local Connecticut breweries. Like I said, we don't want to make the beer. We just want to sell the beer.
Yeah, I think judging from your history on Main Street, you've done a great job down there bringing something together, and you've started a lot of the people along the way. This sounds like a nice fit into the neighborhood, a nice reach out to the neighbors. I'm not a hospitality consultant or any of that. I'll leave that to George. But
you do very well at it.
But I think you're on the right track with this, and I'm confident you'll make this fit into the community and with your. You've already reached out to your neighbors, and that's to help you with your program.
We appreciate that. Thank you.
Supporting of this.
Thank you.
A couple things here might help you. The walkway inside, where you're going to expand toward the new cafe seating area, your counter, that's kind of a walkway out that door. bothers me when I look at your diagram here. And I was down there with you going through the other day.
Right.
I wonder about that. That's just a suggestion.
Like the flow of people, you're saying people sitting at that cafe counter and then people walking.
He told me that's gonna expand out. It shows it here.
About 6 feet, right.
And it might get in the way and it's not a nice walkway through. You'd have to go out to the new cafe seating area, cut out. Maybe you want that done so that they move around in that area, because you do sell in that area.
Yeah, it's like I said, you know, we're working with, working on with an architect. Those things might.
That's a suggestion. You want to take a good look at that.
Yeah, we will. A big thing will be also, though, we have like a spine of retail that's there now, that's made out of old Comstock Ferry seed bins and stuff like that. All that will be completely removed.
And I know you can't deal with this area because there's structure right in there.
Yeah, there's pillars all over the place. Yeah.
Stuff part of it.
Right.
What's the existing seed shop area in front? Is that exists there now? But you had events in there.
That's now our event space. So we moved the seeds down into the main retail portion, and we do we host our events up in that front area. So we have seating for up to 49 people up there.
So you're going to continue with that way?
You know, we're that's kind of a,
not sure.
It's kind of in development, but it's okay. It's kind of something that lends itself nicely right now, because there's a lot of parties that are only 15 people. They still want their own space, and that's what we can offer them today. Whether it stays like that, whether that turns into something else, it's kind of Comstock Ferry is one of those pieces of property. If you try to take it all in, you're going to get in your car and drive. you're going to run as fast as you can. So we're just forcing ourselves to focus on the things that will help us be a better heirloom market. And those three things are having a real kitchen, having an event space, and having a more functional cafe area with real refrigeration and real cooking equipment, so that we can kind of keep doing what we're doing much more efficiently.
I'm glad to see you doing something with it, because it disappoints me to have all that beautiful space in historic Weathersfield not being better used or more used.
Well, we're excited to be doing something.
You're going in the right direction.
Yeah.
Well, we appreciate it. Thank you.
I mean, a huge part of that is that we're actually about to be buying the property. So,
and
we haven't been able to do anything with it because we were not able to sublet.
Right. And the barn down the street has a lot of events there.
Yeah.
So you can capitalize on that kind of thing, and I think there can be more of it in all weathers.
So a modest second option.
Just a general question for the, so there's the heirloom that we know and love now, and then the event space in the back. Do you envision, maybe not during the event time, but during like the typical tap room hours, that there would be like a lot of back and forth? So like, oh, hey, they're cooking some awesome muffins over there, so let's go grab one of those, bring it back.
Yeah.
Because, like, the logistics of that, does that add anything in the conversations that you've had in terms of, like, the lighting that you would need and the paths that you would need in between the two?
Sure, a lot of that. We're still discussing and taking the advice of the liquor department, the liquor control.
Yeah.
I mean, we have to speak to them, continue our conversations with them about, what does that look like? If we were to do it just this way, what are the requirements in terms of food being served in the barn, as opposed to, do they consider it the same thing? A lot
right.
of places you have to have food being served
or
in the space.
Get
right. So I mean, some of these things are kind of like fluid. We'll have to make decisions based on obviously requirements. But in terms of the lights going down, there's the only existing lights out there right now is that there is a light here. We'll re-angle this light because it does kind of, even though they say it's fine, but our neighbors that just built the house there, that light does kind of cast quite a bit, and it's on a timer. I don't even know where the controls are for that thing, but we'll direct it down so that it doesn't blind them. But the only thing that we can imagine for outdoor lighting would be just lighting on either side of these doors here, so that, and then maybe some landscape lighting down low, so just for safety. And to make it look nice, and then probably lighting on either side of these doors, something that matches the aesthetic of the building and the time.
Be careful of the walkway you're going to put in, too.
Yeah, we'd have to have something there.
So, I mean, I think that maybe like, whether it be landscape lighting, whether it be something, but it wouldn't be something
Then you said you're going to stay in the building to me, too.
Right, right. Right, well, a lot of...
I didn't realize it was getting bad, it just was done.
Yeah, if our financing goes through the way, as we hope, then we'll be repairing some of the roofs and restaining the property, and then also the back barns. Whereas we won't be residing anything, we'll be repairing and then painting so that it just looks all kind of consistent as opposed to, so that it looks, it'll look, it won't look new, but it'll look freshened up.
Were you still planning on selling the seeds as well, or will that be phased out eventually?
We'll be selling the seeds as long as we're on that property. That's something that, yeah, it doesn't really make, there's a lot of other places that you can go open up a similar business as this and have it be, quite frankly, like a lot easier and less expensive. But if you're in this place and you don't kind of embrace all that comes with it, and the seeds, believe it or not, are actually something that's really beneficial to our business, even outside of just selling seeds. You know, it definitely, it's a part, it's an identity, adds to the identity of the building. It is the identity of the building, but it adds to the identity of our business. Mm-hmm. So we embrace it, and I don't see us changing that anytime soon.
That's the right answer.
We have a consignment agreement going forward if the purchase of the property with Baker Creek, the current land there. So that'll to continue that. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You mentioned 49 people seating area in the front section. If you open up the new cafe seating area, the greenhouse, the new patio, and the event hall in the back, do you have an idea what the capacity would be for one primary event?
Well, we wouldn't open up the greenhouse. The greenhouse wouldn't be open to seating. That's a romantic idea that we would be years and years away from even addressing, just because we frankly don't have the money to do what we would need to do to the greenhouse to get a certificate of occupancy for that space. Because I believe that we would probably have to really address the ground, the floor. When we first went to get insurance, it's only open for staff. And the reason is because there's gravel, there's wood, there's lips, there's all different levels, and it's just a hazard somebody could trip. So we're not gonna be doing anything inside there in terms of the public anytime soon. But I think that one decision that we'll probably have to make due to capacity and what that requires in terms of parking, stuff like that, is I wouldn't be surprised if would have to make a decision between, you know, keeping the front room, doing what we're doing now, and having the barn.
With limitations possibly by the fire marshal.
Exactly.
Think. Yeah,
exactly.
We still have to figure out what the actual, zoning is for that back barn space that we want to turn into event space, and see what the capacity is back there. I think just from doing like a square footage idea in my head that there, it's probably around 100 for capacity in that room.
Then you gotta do all the bathrooms, Andy.
Yep, we're doing that. That's part of the plan, the bathrooms, and maybe, possibly even adding. There's two existing bathrooms that are just not in great shape. They'll be revamped and maybe even added. Like maybe there'll be a third stall or even like a second stall in each added.
There's no sprinklers out there now, are there?
Not currently.
No. Yeah. And that's part of what we're trying to figure out with the zoning of that space as to what we need to do. I think right now, and what we're hoping is that we just need to do the new alarm system and have it all connect, hopefully. But if not, and we have to put sprinklers out there, then we'll address that.
What do you think your hours of operation would be?
Total, like everything. I would say we'll probably extend the cafe, just the regular market hours a little bit, maybe till like, right now we're open till 5. It might be like 7 or 8, 9 at the most. And it might be more of like a Thursday, Friday thing or a Wednesday, Friday thing.
Right.
And then the barn space would be the same and then contingent on events if we had something that went till 9 or 10 o'clock on a Friday or Saturday for a wedding.
There might be a slight difference between the barn and the cafe, whereas we may very well see that the barn and that business is more of a Thursday through Sunday, closing earliest on Sunday. Mm-hmm. It's kind of a model that's kind of out there. So we've been looking at a lot of those brewery models. A lot of them will be closed by 3-4 o'clock on a Sunday. Or, and really the after.
Limited hours.
Right, right. Fridays and Saturdays. Saturday afternoons and Sunday afternoons are probably the busiest time.
the outside patio, would you have anything more than seating out there? No fire pits or extra lighting or anything like that, is it now? Or?
If it was a dream, we'd love to put a wood-fired oven out there. Yeah. But who knows? I mean, you know, but I think that as right now, in terms of the finances that we have allocated for the project, we know that it's going to go very quickly. So right now would be making a safe walkway through there and having a patio large enough for possibly a few picnic tables.
Good luck.
Thank you.
Peter, you and the building staff will work with their architects and with them on this closely.
Yeah, as I said, they've already had an initial meeting with some of the fire marshal and building. Actually, I don't know if the building guys made it or not to the meeting, so we probably need to reconvene that group. The Historic District Commission staff did attend the meeting. They're not proposing a lot on the outside that really would be a problem. So it's more of the inside, the fire code and the building code, and then figuring out the parking. Those are the real big issues. That the bathrooms, that's going to have to be a conversation, how much bathroom capacity they need primarily for the event space, because it's in the other building. And so some of those logistics, and obviously the state liquor control people, so there are issues. And as the details develop, to answer your question, of course we'll be working closely with them on that.
Okay, so if I could just recap any of the issues that came up just now, I would say we're parking for sure. We'll need to address that because obviously the town will be interested. Flow of traffic, flow of people, the hours that will be open, and then of course, you know, fire code and bathrooms and, you know, meeting all those state liquor control regulations and all of that. But aside from that,
and the outside activities.
Yeah, just a sensitivity to the
neighbors.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Obviously, as part of your process, you should have a separate reach out to those neighbors.
Absolutely.
Who are going to be
yes.
most affected before you finalize things, just to make sure,
right.
you know, you've dealt with those issues before the public hearings, if
sure.
there's some strong concerns. I think if it's going to be an event space, if there's anything you can do to insulate so that the sound is kept
Yeah.
inside, if you're going to have, you know, loud events. Obviously related to that would be heating and cooling. If the doors have to be open because the heating and cooling is inadequate, those are things that, you know, our experience indicates you need to be thinking about, so that the doors aren't wide open. Therefore, you know, the noise is going right, you know, to the neighbors. So,
thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yeah,
and we appreciate it. Thank you.
Yep.
We'll see you soon, hopefully.
Hey, we got some minutes.
Back.
Welcome back.
Yeah. Motion to approve the February 19th minutes.
Wait a minute. I gave you a second, but I have a question on one of them. Excuse me a minute. Very top of page 5, first line. The highest form of land use available to the town is open for discussion, but there probably is demand across all. Should it be two sentences? I'm not quite sure. Maybe it makes sense for the rest of you.
No, I think.
I just can't read it.
I think the gist of it is not so much if this use, it's whether this use is the highest form of land use. Is open to discussion, comma, but there probably is demand for it across all demographics.
Oh, so a comma could do it, maybe?
Yeah, I think so, because I mean, it was
basically
saying I couldn't commit that this was the best use of that property, but there is demand for that type of product.
Okay. I just thought the wording.
So page 4 and 5, bottom top of page, okay.
Make a motion to approve, did we?
So you're a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? All righty. Any staff reports? When is the
So the CFPZA event is March 26th.
Okay.
The deadline for us making reservations is March 20th. I think a couple folks have. So the award winners, Tom and Joe, definitely. Anyone else who wants to join the fun and festivities at the AquaTurf, let us know. Rich?
Yep.
Tom? Any other? George, no?
Can't go.
George can't go?
Going away.
And Tom, did you have your hand up?
Yeah.
I got two Toms.
Oh, I'm not going then.
All right. We got a
different table.
Roni Homicki.
We'll sit with the ZBA or something.
So that's four plus two, so it'll be a total of six, and then whatever staff members, now that all you guys are gone, maybe we won't go as staff, so. Yeah, that'll go over well with the town manager. So there's that, and then the tour of the Borden building was postponed, rescheduled. It has been rescheduled for Friday at lunchtime, Friday, March 20th from 12 to 1. If anyone wants to join us, let us know and we'll add you to the list. So that was rescheduled to March 20th, so let us know.
Add me to the list.
George, okay.
Yeah, me too.
And Tom? Okay.
You have to be able to climb the stairs.
Yeah, so the elevators are not functioning, so as long as you can walk up five flights of stairs.
Got my own hard hat as well.
Okay, perfect.
Certified.
Certified, yes, it means.
Certifiable.
It meets special standards.
Anything else?
One quick question.
Sure.
That property on the Berlin Turnpike, kind of behind Salvation Army or something, the falling down house, it goes down the hill.
Berlin Turnpike, yeah.
Yeah, Berlin Turnpike.
The white house with that goes down the slope property?
Yeah.
Okay.
It says under deposit. Do you know if anybody's?
I think that under deposit sign has been up there for a long time and just has never been changed. I have not talked to anyone interested in that property for maybe a year. That doesn't mean somebody just hasn't randomly put some money down. I'll make a note and see what I can find out, but I'm not aware of anything for that property.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, maybe the sign's been there forever and
yep.
I just finally noticed it, but yep. I was curious if you'd heard anything. That is all.
Okay.
Any news on the other property in the Berlin Turnpike? Restaurant?
The restaurant, no. It's it's
got siding on it.
Two steps forward and maybe sometimes three steps back, but and the problem with that is, and we've looked at, they have been cited for some property maintenance violations, but from a building permit point of view, as long as they make some level of activity for periods of time, there's really nothing that can be done. Actually, the town manager and I have both met with the new owner to try and encourage that along. We had him attend the energy breakfast, you know, to see maybe that money might help him, and just doesn't seem to have moved things along.
History in, and I can ask our lawyers for that too, on building permits, that they exist forever?
As long as they are working on them in
activity.
Some fashion, yeah.
As long as you don't basically sit on it for a year.
What means no activity? 6 months, a year, what?
A year.
Who knows, right?
Yeah.
No case law in there, really, Rich?
No, it's if you aren't doing something for a year, I think they have the right to revoke the building permit.
Oh, really?
But they can just simply apply for another building permit, and
yeah.
You know, you're back to where you. So we've just tried to.
People get mad, and $200-something.
You would think, you know, they would want the restaurant to be open and, you know, making some money, but.
There should be a way of encouraging to move along.
We've been doing the encouraging part of it, so.
I'll entertain a motion to close.
So moved.
Thank you both. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye.